Well, get ready for another round of Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations, the 17th round to be exact. And still very little information about this massive international collaboration is actually known. Government officials in 12 countries are meeting with the representatives from over 600 businesses to discuss international free trade. Talks are set to end in October, with individual governments voting on the agreement shortly after. If passed, it would be the biggest trade agreement in history. But something this big isn't without its fair share of critics. Groups have criticized the secrecy of these negotiations, the breadth of what the TPP actually covers, and the possibility of it overriding individual country laws, and so much more. One of those critics is Lori Wallisch. She's the director of a Public Citizens Global Trade Watch. Thank you so much for joining me. So let's start off by talking about this schedule that they have in Lima and the 17th round of negotiations. It's still very unclear what they are doing. They put out a schedule giving us some type of idea of what's going on. And it involves lots of activities for stakeholders. But what really do we know about what's going on there aside from this little very vague release?
Well, unfortunately, the schedule is typically the same, whatever they put on paper. Representatives from 11 countries meet together behind closed doors. In the lobbies and in meetings before and after are corporate representatives trying to influence the talks. The meetings and negotiations are trying to set up a set of binding international rules that each of the countries would have to conform all of their domestic laws to. Most of it has nothing to do with trade. Rather, all of these negotiators are sitting down, despite the fact that their parliaments or congresses are doing business as normal, and rewriting huge parts of their domestic law. So, for instance, one of the things I know they're talking about this round of negotiations is the 17th time in 3 years that they've gotten together, and before that was a whole year under Bush. So since 2008, this dance has been going on in the dark. This time they're talking about visas for workers, countries in this involved in Vietnam, Australia, New Zealand, Singapore, Malaysia, visas for workers to come here and work. And you would say, isn't Congress having a discussion right now about immigration? Why are they having this similar discussion behind closed doors between a few countries? Very good question. Lots of issues like that are in the TPP. Financial deregulation, requiring us to import food that doesn't meet our standards, limits on internet freedom, and, very scary, a proposal to set up tribunals outside our court system where foreign corporations could directly sue our governments and grab our tax dollars right out of the treasury.
That's a very interesting point, and I think you did a really good job kind of wrapping up all the dangers that critics have of this behind-the-doors negotiations. One of the aspects that really caught my attention while I was researching this is that negotiators within the U.S. are lobbying for the fact that they don't want Congress to be able to debate it. They want simply a yes or a no answer. It's called fast-tracking. Talk about the dangers of fast-tracking.
So fast-track is a very arcane procedure used only 16 times since it was cooked up by, shocker, Richard Nixon. So it was first in 1974 when trade agreements really only covered real trade stuff like border taxes, tariffs, came up with this procedure, and the idea was to speed through Congress with no amendments, limited debate, tariff cuts. Well, now here comes a trade negotiation. It's really like a misbranding, right? The TPP is much bigger than trade. And the idea that is now being kicked around by some of the really big businesses and President Obama is to get this arcane procedure, and this is how it works. The executive branch gets to negotiate and sign an agreement without Congress actually getting to vote first. It then gets to write legislation changing all of our domestic laws to meet the agreement it negotiated and signed without Congress. It then gets to send it to Congress, and the normal committee procedure is forbidden. No review, no amendments in committee. And then it goes to the floor, 45 days, automatic yes or no votes. No amendments, 20 hours of debate, House, Senate. It's like a legislative luge run. You can put any terrible thing, and sheer force of gravity takes it right through Congress and into our lives. Very dangerous. You don't need this, obviously, to pass an agreement that the public would like. You only need this to shove through Congress something that is bad for the country. And so this is the process that got us into the World Trade Organization, that got us into NAFTA, But we've had hundreds of decent trade agreements that didn't use this. So very dangerous process, but it only can go into place if Congress agrees. So we all have the ability by telling our members of Congress, they have constitutional exclusive authority over trade, and we better tell them they need to stick to their authority, not give it away. We expect them to work for us. And that starts with not giving away their power to make sure we have good trade agreements.
Very interesting conversation. Thank you so much for coming into the studio. Lori Wallace, Director of Public Citizens Global Trade Watch, thank you so much.
Thank you.